Yep, we are good to go. Alrighty, so thank you, Susan, again so much for taking time out of your afternoon to talk with me. Super excited. I know a little bit about what's going on with JCPRD and the Arts and Heritage Center, but I wanted everybody else to know too. So we are live on Facebook. So anybody who's watching, if you have comments or questions, feel free to write them in the chat and we'll try to answer them as best we can. So this is Susan Mong, and she is the Superintendent of Culture at JCPRD, which is Johnson County Parks and Rec Department.
Good job, you did it.
Thank you. No, I'm like superintendent, that's such a big word, but what does that actually mean, Superintendent of Culture?
That's a great question. So there are 5 different divisions within Johnson County Park and Recreation District. And so there's a superintendent that oversees each of those divisions and the team of people that are part of those. So superintendent is really just a fancy word for helping, you know, again, a team to succeed and removing barriers and creating a good environment for them to do their amazing work. So I get to work alongside, again, that amazing team that makes up the culture division. So, yeah.
Awesome. Very cool. So my first question for you is, what is your professional background? How did you get to where you are now?
Well, thank you for that question. I love asking that of others too, because rarely, I think, is there a straight line that anybody experiences in their professional career. And that's part of the fun of it, really.
Right.
And sometimes we have to get out of our own way to kind of make it to that next or through that journey. But I'm turning 50 this year. And so it's kind of a long journey. I won't go through all the details, but I will share that I spent probably the first 15 years of my career in volunteer management, which was a really beautiful place to start. I was at KU Medical Center for a number of years, so really was entrenched in the healthcare system, and then made my way to a nonprofit called Reach Out and Read, Kansas City, that's all about early literacy and making sure that that's introduced to every child, especially in vulnerable parts of Kansas City. And I'm so thankful that I had my start in volunteer management, because the people, the mindsets that the volunteers that I worked with had, it imprinted on me really strongly. And, you know, these are individuals that give of their time and feel a sense of duty to their community to make a difference. And some of the people that I had the privilege of working with, many from the greatest generation, the average age of my friends back during that time was really, really high, because I just got to know these amazing people that were, again, in that quote unquote retirement season of their life, but yet they didn't see it as a time to sit back, but really lean in and give to their community. So really grateful for my journey in volunteer management. And that led me to the Johnson County Public Library. Eventually, I had a few kids in there. And so there's always a little bit of a winding path as you're adding little ones to your life. But I did return full time to work at the Johnson County Library and started there managing that volunteer program. And then had a wonderful leader, I'll say his name actually, Sean Casserly, who saw something in me that I didn't see in myself at that time. And that was to step into the fundraising role, the foundation director for the Johnson County Library Foundation. And that transitioned me into a really exciting area. And it's not unlike volunteerism in that you're really connecting people with people to not just give of their time, but of their resources to causes and missions that matter to them. Yeah. So, that was a really great period of growth for me, because it was sort of that decision to step outside my comfort zone into something that I really didn't feel like I had all the skill sets to do, but I sort of learned on the job, so to speak. I pursued a master's degree kind of during that time frame for public administration.
Okay, cool.
So public service, sort of that began to become clear to me when I was at the hospital, just that I really wanted, whatever I did, I wanted to be a part of an organization that was about public service. Mm-hmm. And so it felt like a natural progression for me to pursue that as a master's degree. I had three kids under the age of 11, and then I was working full time, and I was just kind of trying to carve that degree out one class at a time. So it took about 4 years, but it was really an important part for me of developing leadership skills and just kind of what it takes to continue to grow and learn and be ready for the next thing. So I will just say then I transitioned over to Johnson County Park and Recreation District, still within the county, and joined the finance team. And it was about a year in that this new division called the Culture Division was launched. And I just feel really privileged that Jill Geller at the time gave me that opportunity to step into this role. So I definitely feel very grateful for the people that have created those opportunities and believed in me enough to step into those. So it's a real privilege to serve alongside some really talented people here at the Arts and Heritage Center.
Yeah, definitely.
So, quick summary there.
Yeah, that's perfect. So we talked a little bit about you being a superintendent of culture. Mm-hmm. But let's go a little bit more into mm-hmm. your role. And can you tell us, I'm curious, what is your role within JCPRD as a whole? And then also within the culture division at the Arts and Heritage Center?
Yeah, great question. Well, Johnson County Park and Recreation District is such a large and diverse organization. And we do so many things throughout the county. Of course, well, there are 17 amazing regional parks, for example. We have 17 different facilities that we run. There's over 300 staff that are a part of the organization. So many amazing things. So I get to sit alongside some other leaders. I think I mentioned there are five superintendents, and then we have our overall leadership team. So being able to contribute to the strategic mission and just overall culture of the organization is really exciting. But I feel very energized about the work that's happening out of this cultural hub, the Arts and Heritage Center, and how that's contributing to the overall mission of JCPRD, how we're beginning to sort of incorporate the arts and culture into other aspects mm-hmm. of the organization. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later, but why we see the Arts and Heritage Center as a cultural hub, we're definitely taking all of the efforts out into the community more and just trying to intersect what we're doing within our division with other areas. So in the parks, you know, bringing concerts there. I know we'll talk about the public art program that's coming yep. soon as well, but just embedding those experiences into other areas of the county where it hasn't been previously. So that's pretty exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. And I'd like to just also step through for those that don't know what's a part of our division, if that's okay, Allison.
Yeah, absolutely.
Theater in the Park, many people know Theater in the Park. Of course, it's been a part of our community for over 50 years. And so that's a really exciting and vibrant part of our division. The Johnson County Museum, which has the main museum location here at the Arts and Heritage Center, but also has the Lanesfield Historic School that's out in Edgerton, and just lots of exciting things, lots of community engagement programs and great things happening at the museum. We have our facility rentals department that some wouldn't necessarily think of, and that includes about six different rental locations around the county. We have the public art program that was just launched, and then our fine and performing arts effort, which includes, as you know, the art exhibition space, which is amazing. And then just amazing programs at camps, classes for kids, for adults that are happening here on a regular basis. So yeah, lots to discover there for the community, for sure.
Definitely. Yeah, it's a great space.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess we can go ahead and talk about the next thing, which is projects that are coming up in 2021. So do you want to talk a little bit about things that are happening at the Arts and Heritage Center. And yeah, you talked about more, you know, reaching out into the community. And so just curious if there were projects like that going on.
Well, I know I appreciate that question. And so I think I'll start off by sharing that certainly as we've all, we're seeing a little bit of progress or a positive trajectory. Is that the right way to say that word?
Yeah.
Out of the pandemic, and but as we're still moving through that, we've really embraced sort of our role and how we can contribute to the community's wellness and feeling of joy. And so we will be continuing to partner with the Kansas City Symphony to bring music into the parks this spring. And hopefully some of you listening out there, or Allison, I don't know if you had a chance to take in a concert in our parks, but it was really well received. And again, people, I think, felt like they could come out safely and just be able to have that experience in a natural setting. So something that the symphony wasn't doing pre-pandemic, that's kind of a lovely outcome from all of this. So dates will be set for that soon. We will also be welcoming the Lyric Opera to perform at Meadowbrook Park in April. So that will be another new opportunity to experience culture in the parks. So we're very excited about that. Another new initiative that our museum team is really leading out on is the Historic Marker Project. Mm-hmm. And I think that as the community heads into our parks and experiences the beautiful natural environment across those 17 different parks, there's some real opportunity for us to help our visitors understand the history of that land, the stories that are untold. So we're really excited to take the amazing talent that we have in the museum team and help bring that project to life so that, our community feels a greater sense of place and can appreciate the history again of the parks as they are today, but as they were many years ago as well. So our first installation will actually be at Shawnee Mission Park at Barclay Plaza. And our team is working really hard on those historical markers, but again, more to come in that way to just again create that greater sense of connection to our community. So historical markers, that's an exciting one. Theater in the Park, they went dark last year. They did do some virtual program offerings like many organizations, but they are planning, they're planning one more virtual production this spring. Songs for a New Now is the title of that. So I encourage everyone to check that out. That'll be debuting in April. But we have all the plans set to have a summer season and to move forward with that. And auditions will be happening in March. So go to the Theater in the Park website if there's anyone interested in auditioning for one of those productions. But Theater in the Park will definitely be excited to engage our community. One of the really cool things about Theater in the Park is that it's all of the productions are made up of friends, members of the community. It's not a trailer rolling in with a team of performers and musicians from some other place. We're really highlighting and building these beautiful productions based on the talent that we have here locally. So I love to talk about that because it's not a common effort that you see in many communities. So I hope everybody will support that as we launch that. This spring virtually, but then this summer in person. Let's see here. Place of Peace, which is a beautiful exhibit that just opened last week. And I know Devin was on a few weeks ago talking about that. So I won't go into a lot more detail, but I hope people will go back and learn about that project and how special that is to our building here and how beautiful the space looks. So invite everybody to take that in. Let me think here. Well, we have been serving as a vaccine site in partnership with the health department that's sort of transitioning a little bit, but that's been a role that we've been proud to play, and mostly for healthcare workers that have gotten their vaccination, both of those completed through the building here. So that's been an unusual role that we've played, but I expect that to taper off a little bit as we move forward. Other projects, let me think here. Oh, our museum gift shop will be expanding a little bit. So I will mention for those that have not had a chance to visit the museum gift shop, there are some really lovely gift items there. And we've actually seen a growth in sales in that way, which is pretty amazing given the pandemic.
Yeah.
So we'll have an expanded footprint for our gift shop, and we're already seeing people that are coming really just even to shop there for special gifts and things of that nature. So that is coming definitely, and we'll transform our building a little bit. Let's see. I will mention that out in Edgerton, Lanesfield Historic School, there is a visitor center that is located on that site as well. And so our museum team will be giving it a makeover, we'll say, and adding a lot more historical data about the town of Lanesfield itself. So that'll be something that I encourage everyone to head out south to Edgerton and check out once that's all complete. It's really a beautiful, beautiful site and really a great drive out to that part of the county.
Yeah.
So let's see here. And then the public art program is a big one. We are in the middle of a master plan process right now. And I think that we have maybe a question later on that, but we are right now just engaging with the community, doing a lot of listening, and just trying to understand where our public art effort can complement, not duplicate or compete or any of that, but where public art in our park system can really play a different role than we see in some of the other urban areas of the county or even in downtown Kansas City. So that's a big effort. And again, really, even in the midst of the pandemic, using all of the technology available to us, we're trying to make sure that we get all the right voices to the table to learn and listen there.
Yeah.
So that's a little bit of a taste, and I probably am forgetting something
that's okay.
All of that, but I'll pause and let you.
That is a lot, and it sounds amazing. Most of it I knew about, but there were a couple of things that I didn't know about, and so that's really exciting. I think if you want to go ahead and we can talk about the Public Art Committee a little bit more. Yeah. I will say, as an artist, I was able to join in the conversations, which was really great. And to hear a lot about what other artists thought, you know, would be good for the parks or would be good for the community, and making sure that all walks of life are included, mm-hmm. I think was really great. So do you want to talk a little bit about the parks themselves and kind of what the goals are for the Public Art Committee of JCPRD?
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. We, so I will share that really the Public Art Committee as we know it now, and it really just was approved in 2019 by the JCPRD board to move forward. And we have a little bit of funding that's associated with that, which I'm grateful for. And then we hope to have some fundraising support alongside that. But it really started with an artist from the Kansas City Art Institute. And so I have to just give a shout out to Anne-Marie Yang, who approached us. I had just actually started in my role, and she had a senior project there at the Kansas City Art Institute to find somewhere to install an art sculpture, a sculpture project in a public setting. And she lived sort of in the DeSoto area. Lexington Lake Park was a special place for her. And so when she was charged with that, she thought, you know, this is a place that would be meaningful to me to have this. So we embarked on this experiment, I'll call it, dipping our toe in the water around public art. And we were so delighted and I don't know, maybe I was a little surprised too at how the DeSoto community just rallied. The Arts Council of DeSoto, the city, the Rotary Club, they were all so excited about this new piece of public art, this temporary piece coming into their community. And I think at that point we knew that this could be really something special. And yeah, what I love about that story is that was an individual, it was a student. She's not even living in our community anymore. I do keep in touch with her, but really that helped kind of propel us forward. And so we began to kind of try to understand what the policy looks like around that. You know, how do you get the funding? You know, what our board needed to understand about that. Again, these are public parks, and we understand that we have to be really cognizant of our duty to make sure that we're stewarding all of that well. So did a lot of research and you know, kind of stepping back to that professional journey question. I mean, that's been a really great journey for me. I did not know about public art administration. I didn't know about all the challenges and things, you know, happening across the country. And I've learned so much by stepping into that space. And there's so many generous, talented people that have just been so willing to walk that journey with me, and lots of partners in the community. But I will just share that we now have a structure in place, again, to do, we're going to start at the Meadowbrook Park as our first location. And I think our public art committee just was wise, because we could have just launched into our very first permanent art installation project at Meadowbrook, but they really wanted to be more intentional. And so we sort of put the pause button on Meadowbrook Park, and we embarked on a master plan process, which is really a journey again to look over the next 5 to 10 years and try to establish a roadmap for what this program should be, what the goals should be, the vision, who the important stakeholders are that we need to have around the table. Mm-hmm. And so we're in that process right now. And then part of that master plan will really help. I know you asked about what are the goals, and we're going to really get to that answer by the end of this process. So I'm going to have to ask you to hold on that one. And we'll definitely have a very clear vision and a set of goals. And it won't say, the master plan process won't be as specific to say you should have this sculpture at this location, or it'll provide the framework for what we want to accomplish. And some of the aha moments for me have really been talking to some of our trail users, our bikers, our naturalists that help build trails in our parks. We have this amazing, going back to volunteerism, we have an amazing group of volunteers, Urban Trail Company, I think is the name, that literally help build those natural nature trails in our park system. That's a partnership. Mm-hmm. You know, what does it mean for them to have public art? What would be problematic, you know, as we're restoring prairie, for example, in many of our parks?
Right.
We have a biologist that is extremely knowledgeable and is doing important work on prairie restoration. So I want to make sure, we want to make sure that we're not at odds with those other uses, those other goals, and that we're being mindful of how public art can complement that work and help lift that work up and not, you know, be a deterrent or a problem.
Right.
So we're in listening and learning mode right now. We have a great makeup of our public art committee, and then we have a core team that's, again, probably a lot of individuals, you know, that are helping really steer and caution us and provide that important feedback so that we step with intention and strategically. So, and I know you've jumped in, which I really appreciate, as an artist, on one of those round tables to help provide some insight. So yeah, it's been really educational, and that's just where, again, back to that public service, I just love that collaborative mm-hmm. piece and that we're building this together, you know, not in a vacuum. And yeah. So, yeah, a lot more to more exciting things to come there for sure.
Awesome.
So, yeah.
Yeah, that's really great. I love that, you know, ecology and biology and naturalism and all of that is included in your park structures, which I think is so cool. And I'm excited to see what happens with the public art.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I know that another cool thing when that I've at least learned about public art too is, you know, you have temporary and you can have permanent and you can have sort of these interactive experiences. And so there's just a lot of opportunities and there's also a lot of local talent. And I'd be curious to see or to hear from you too on this, but I think I know it's our goal to try to make sure we're engaging with the local artists as much as we can and have them a part of the process. But I also think there can be some barriers, or it can feel intimidating for an artist to approach a public art program because there can be so much, I don't know, requirements and bureaucracy, yeah. or it can feel beyond an artist. And so I think what I'm learning is that we have some work to do as a community to create more on-ramps and more educational opportunities so artists feel like, hey, I can do that. I can step into that space. So I'm definitely looking forward to, sorry, I have a call coming in. That's that noise. So we'll just hang up on that. But I feel a real great responsibility as we're learning about these gaps out there in the world of for artists, how we can help fill that gap and bridge that a little bit so that more artists feel a part of feel like that opportunity can be for them.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah, that was a great part of the conversation that I think we had in that. Mm-hmm. One of the meetings where artists were invited was that, you know, applications and submissions and working with public entities can be really intimidating. And I mean, I personally have not done public art. I have had installations, but they've been kind of like isolated, I guess.
Yeah.
No. So yeah, that was one of the big things for me as an artist, and I know you know quite a few other people, was just getting over that barrier of applying and knowing exactly what to expect, and you know not being scared out of it. So I think that's really great.
Absolutely. So yeah, so I'm looking forward to continuing to learn more and how it could be more of a regional maybe. Partnership. I think about Crystal Bridges or Arkansas and all the cool things that are happening in that community. The bike trails and public art that's sort of embedded. I don't know if you've been down there. I need to take a trip and see all the new things happening. But, you know, I think we can tell a story here in the Kansas City region. I think so that just requires more collaboration and how we can tell that story better and draw people. But right now we're sitting sort of on the cliff and we're looking out at all the possibilities, and I'm just really excited about what's ahead and again how we can create these inspiring experiences in our park spaces. And you know, on the note of parks too, I think I mentioned that we have about 17 regional parks. And they are stunningly beautiful. And I just want to encourage everybody, if you haven't explored our parks, go on our website. Kind of the newest one that's in development now is Cedar Niles, that's in Olathe. Kill Creek Park has this amazing observation tower where you can see beautiful prairies. At sunset, it's stunning. It's ADA accessible. It's a little drive down K-10, but again, we just have some really unique spaces that has very diverse topography. So I'm going to just put a plug in to go out and get inspired, especially as the weather's turning nice. There's just, you know, we have 137 miles of trail. Holy cow. Think about that. Yeah. So whether you're a walker or a biker, get out there and then hopefully in the near future, you'll be able to encounter some cool art along the way when you're visiting as well. But, our parks, I think in 2019, I feel like our numbers were around 7.4 million. Don't quote me totally on that. And this year we had 8.8 million visitors, in 2020, that is. So, I think there's definitely this rediscovery that's happening, and what a gift those spaces have been at a time where we couldn't really go very many places. So I hope that that continues. And again, we plan to get outside of our building here and bring some of those experiences out into those natural spaces as well.
So, yeah.
Some cool stuff to see out there for sure.
Yeah, I've been to a few, but I haven't been to all of them. So I still need to go check them all out. But yeah, really great spaces. And like Susan said, get out there, especially with the weather. I'm super excited for warmer weather.
Oh, I know.
Crazy cold.
Big time, yes.
So we do have a question in our comments. So Vandra Solomon is one of the Arts Council of Johnson County's volunteers, and she's super great. So hi, Vandra. But she asked, she says she also had a career in volunteer management years ago. She asked, do volunteers have a role in JCPRD? And I know you said that the trail, you know, they make that company that you partner with makes, you know, trails. Are there any other volunteer opportunities throughout JCPRD?
Such a great question. And first of all, I want to say thank you to you for volunteering and for giving of your time. And you couldn't pick a better organization. The Arts Council is amazing. So thank you for giving of your time. And we have many, many, many opportunities. We have, I think it's a couple thousand volunteers associated with JCPRD. Here in our division, we have volunteers that are really critical from a leadership standpoint that serve on our boards. And I don't want to gloss over our boards because they are leaders. We have six different boards that we work with that support the work in our division, but also do really important work like fundraising and the Museum Advisory Council, Museum Foundation, Theater Advisory Council, Public Art Committee, the Park and Rec Foundation of Johnson County. So some leadership positions to be advocates, help raise funds, help tell the story in the community. So that's one. And I invite anyone that might be invited interested in board leadership, you know, reach out to me and I could connect you where there may be opportunities if you're interested. So there's that. We also have volunteers who we had to put a pause on, as many did over the last year, but our museum utilizes volunteers on a regular basis, assisting with our visitors to the museum. Our theater in the park crew welcomes volunteers to assist on the nights that we have productions and many other outreach efforts when we have the auditions that are going to be coming up. We need volunteers that can assist with that process, which, by the way, looks a lot like American Idol when you see so many people showing up, standing in line with their, you know, information, just wanting a part in one of the productions. It's the sweetest experience. So a little plug for that volunteer opportunity. And then we have volunteers out in our sports fields that serve as volunteer coaches in our 50 plus program to help with programs. So, I mean, the opportunities are, I don't want to say endless, that wouldn't be accurate, but there are many. And so I will mention that we have a volunteer coordinator that can help connect individuals. And so I wanted to just share that again, anyone's, you know, happy or you're welcome to reach out to me and I can connect you to Faith, our volunteer coordinator, to learn more. But volunteers are the lifeblood of any public organization. And I think that that's a sign of an organization's health, how vibrant the volunteer program is. So I really appreciate that question and would love to talk to anybody about how to get them involved. So, yeah.
Awesome. I love it. Yeah, volunteers are so great and so important.
Absolutely.
So, I just, you know, want to thank you again so much for taking the time out of your afternoon to talk to me. Is there anything else that you want to plug or talk about that I missed or we hadn't touched on? Anything else you can think of?
You know, I guess what I'd love to share with, you know, I shared a lot of information and I know that, but I would encourage everyone to follow us on Facebook, the Arts and Heritage Center Facebook page, the museum Facebook page, and you're going to be able to get a good idea of what's happening, what's coming up. I think just by doing that simple thing, you know, consider being a museum member. You know, we really, we ask, you know, members of the community to support our efforts there and the importance of local history and understanding who we are today based on, you know, what's happened in our community historically. So become a museum member is another great way. You know, come to our productions at Theater in the Park and support, again, local artists that are out there sharing of themselves and being vulnerable and just creating beautiful work. So I would just say, come to our building, follow us, let us know how we can serve you better. I would love to hear any feedback anyone has. And then I just want to again say that our team of staff is so talented. They're so public service minded. And the measure of success, the way I measure my success is by how supported they feel in their work. And that's something I'm going to strive to continue to do. But I just want to say that to everyone out there that we have an amazing staff that's here to serve you. And we wanted to provide you with inspiring, joyful, challenging, and educational opportunities. So come check us out. And yeah, I just appreciate the opportunity to join you today. So thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for all of the great information. And yeah, like Susan said, check them out on Facebook, social media, get out to the parks and check out Theater in the Park, all of that fun stuff that you guys are doing. I don't think we have any other questions. So I will let you go back to your day. But thank you again so much for talking to me. And we'll see you later.
Yeah, and thanks to the Arts Council of Johnson County. You guys are doing awesome work. So.
Thank you. All right. All right, bye, Susan.
Take care. Bye-bye.